All right, good afternoon. TJ Smith, Chief of Communications for Baltimore Police Department. You'll hear from today Commissioner Gary Tuggle, G-A-R-Y-T-U-G-G-L-E, and Deputy Commissioner of Operations Andre Bonaparte, Andre A-N-D-R-E-B-O-N-A-P-A-R-T-E. So we're going to turn it over to Commissioner Tuggle, and we'll go from there.
Good morning. How's everybody doing? Good. Hey, yesterday we went live with some very important technology, technology that we feel is going to aid us significantly in the crime fight. We add this technology to our strategic decision support centers in the Eastern and Western District, and that technology is ShotsSpotter technology. We're using it within let me first tell you how it works. This technology detects gunfire. After that detection, officers who are working in those districts have apps on their phones, their smartphones, and they're notified instantaneously of the activity. That information is also sent to dispatch, and then call for service is dispatched as a result of that. So let us give you a really quick demonstration of it, and then we'll take questions after that.
Okay. So since the launch yesterday at 5, we've had 4 instances where shots were fired. No victims in any of those scenarios, which is something that's uncommon. And we want to stress that we want people to still call 911. This is not a substitute for 911. So what you're going to see first is just the map that shows the areas that we've seen shots fired, where we had shots fired, where it was picked up by ShotsSpotter. This one here in the middle on Lafayette was actually the testing phase that we were doing just the other day that we had talked about. And the ones around it are actual situations where a gun was fired in those scenarios. So this is the web-based version. I'm going to do a demonstration with the iPad to show you more of a simulation of what the officers would get on their smartphones. But it's pretty much the same thing that you would get here. So again, we have our list of calls, and we'll go to the most recent one, which was in the area of Bentlow Street. So this is what the officer will see and get. It'll come up, and I apologize. We're running a little slow because of the internet. Make sure we're hooked up to the internet. So that was a single shot, and I apologize. The map should load, and I think right now, because we're having some internet connectivity, of course it worked when we were testing it. Let's see. There we go. All right. So this is what the officers would get. They would actually see a map of the area. They can actually toggle to street view. So you're getting instantaneous intelligence as an officer before you even respond to the area where this occurred. And now that I have the map up, I'll just show you again. So they'll be able to hear what occurred. And this is, 45 seconds?
Yeah.
So that's one demonstration of this. Let me go back to the list and show another. That happened last night, I can't see the overnight, at 1:37 in the morning.
So this morning,
1:37? Yes. So yesterday afternoon at about 6:08, or at 6:08, we had this one on Utah Place. And again, we had no victims in this. As we listened to this, we thought that there could be more than one gun that was fired in this scenario, and that's something that the analysts would look at further to try to distinguish the caliber gun, et cetera. So let me refresh again, as it looks like the page, so we can try to get the... And my apologies, it's a little slow on the internet today. Always something. All right, we'll come back to that in just a second. Let me
All right, so while he's doing his tech guru stuff, I just want to talk about how very important this technology is, but also underscore the fact that it is not a substitute for 911. If people are hearing gunshots, they need to dial 911. In terms of the overall integration of it, I'd like to ask Deputy Commissioner Bonaparte to address that within the SDSCs.
Sure. Good afternoon or good morning, everyone. How are you? So the ShotSpotter technology is integrated into our two SDSC rooms. One is located in the Eastern District and the other one is in the Western District. The Western District ShotSpotter technology has, as TJ and the Commissioner has stated, was launched yesterday at about 5 p.m. And then we've seen some examples of some of the gunshots that have occurred at various places throughout West Baltimore. Again, this is another tool in the toolbox that helps us with crime fighting in the city. It gives a dual response. Once it goes to the SDSC room, analysts there can dispatch off of it, as well as there's a dual response through the communication, and then another response actually off of the app that's located on each police officer's phone. So, And essentially what occurs is once a shot is detected, it goes to an analyst, and then it comes back to be dispatched, and that's how we know that the shots have been fired.
So let me go ahead. I think we're good to go now. So this, again, is Utah Police. This was our first instance of this actually occurring. And this was multiple rounds fired. No victim in the scenario. And again, just from our ears, we think that it could have been more than one gun. Again, it's very, very quick, and it gives the officers the aerial view. They have the ability to toggle to get a street view to know what they're about to walk into. And this is happening really quickly. This is not this long, drawn-out process. They're getting this information before call for services dispatch. However, we still want those calls for service because this is a chain of events. Shots fired, we know we're on our way. We see a guy running this way. We see a girl running this way. We know this person, this incident just occurred. So we're putting everything together to give to the officers, and this is one portion of it. Yeah, right. So my apologies, I'm doing it from, all right. So again, I'll just go ahead and play this one as well. This was in the area of Duklin. And the date and time is on there. This was about 9:30 last night. So again, that's where we are at this point, and wanna open it up for a few questions.
This is good. This is in East and West Baltimore?
Yes.
Or just West? West.
Well, West Baltimore for now.
Okay.
It will be in East Baltimore as of the end of this month.
Okay, so and they'll all be plugged into those SDSCs on either side.
That's correct.
Do you guys know or have you been keeping track of how quickly your officers got to that?
Yes. The response has been quicker. You know, obviously the technology, the first day getting people used to it, but the response time has certainly, I don't have the exact time, but I do know that it was quicker than normal because they had that ability to actually see it on their phone. And we spoke with an officer yesterday who actually said that it registered on their phone and they responded there.
So they have a ShotSpotter app on their phone?
Sure. Yes.
And I'm going to demonstrate that for you on the iPad, which is the same version that would be on the Android or the iOS device.
I have a question. The acoustic experts, are they within your police department here, or are they somewhere else?
They're sitting someplace else, right? So they're sitting someplace. They're analyzing those shots or that noise to distinguish gunshots from other things like mm-hmm. firecrackers. And then once that analysis is done, and it's really, really quick. In some cases, I've heard as little as 45 seconds from the time of detection to the time of broadcast. As you may well know, Chicago also has this technology. They've been sort of mentoring us with respect to the SDSCs as well as ShotSpotter, and it's they've seen double-digit reductions in their shootings in their worst districts. So it's the proof of concept works there, and we're very confident in its ability to work here.
That was going to be my next question. Other cities where this has been implemented quite successfully, is Chicago the main one that you looked at, or did you look at the data?
We'll hand out a fact sheet to you after this is over with that has some example cities that have used it and seen the reductions. And as the commissioner was stating, our Eastern District and our Western District are our smallest districts and have historically seen the disproportionate amount of gun violence. And this year, Western District and Eastern District 1 and 2 with the gun violence from homicides and non-fatal shootings. So that's where we strategically started our launch.
So 5 square miles in the Eastern.
In the Western.
And then 5 square miles in the Western, then another 5 square miles in the Eastern.
Yep.
For a total of 10 when you're done with the installation here?
Yes.
Are there plans for anywhere else?
Well, as obviously we're showing proof of the concept within those districts and those SDSCs, we want to be very strategic about how we employ this. We want to make sure it has the value that we need. And if we need to visit that in the future, we'll do that. If we need to deploy it in some other districts in the future and we think it'll bring value, yes, we'll do it.
Commissioner, how do you see this as a deterrent? I mean, if people see this news and say, oh, in the Western District, I mean, how do you see that playing out?
Well, you know, in terms of deterrent, I don't necessarily know how much it's going to deter somebody. We're trying to make our response time a lot quicker. And I think that's where the value, true value in it is. And if we can do that by getting that detection, and then getting that information to those line officers that have the app on their phones and they're being notified within 45 seconds, it will help and enhance our response time. So, but the bottom line is, you can't control somebody's intent. If somebody wants to go and shoot at somebody, they're going to do it. If they're going to be, whether they're going to be cognizant of a 5-mile radius, we just don't know that.
And just to piggyback on that, this technology touches more than just Western District alone. It touches other districts, and other officers outside of the Western District also have the app. So again, you could be just over the line in the Southwest District, and an event happens in that tri-district area, it'll allow for the quick response from all of the officers that work in that general area.
Are there analysts in these SDSCs now that when one of these shootings comes up, that they know what cameras to bring up, or is there something that triggers the cameras that you may have in the area? Is that how that works in the centers?
Well, yes, we do have analysts in the centers. That technology that I think you're referring to in terms of the integration where the camera will actually focus, we don't have those abilities yet, but we do have camera monitors in the SDSC rooms that can do that, as well as the City Watch program.
So it's happening manually.
Right. And so that technology does exist, mm-hmm. and that's something that we want to move to eventually as we look to build. We're still building out the SDSCs. It's not completed yet, but that's the technology that we want. We want to be able to take all of that data, right, and get it into one area to help us respond better. And integrating the ShotSpotter technology with our camera technologies is going to be a home run for us.
Are the sensors, I'm sorry, I wonder if they're visible.
No, they're not.
That you can't see
them
from the street.
No, they're not.
This was a big piece of technology to come online for the SDSCs, right? This is one of the big ones you were waiting for.
Sure.
But the bigger one is the predictive software, too, right?
That's another part of it.
Has the city decided to contract with Crimescape yet? And if they have, do you know when you're actually going to get that software to pull all this together?
We haven't made a decision in terms of the predictive software yet. We're actually looking at a couple different vendors as well. So we a little bit more research on that. We hope to have that online very shortly.
Do you have a time frame, sometime this summer, in a month?
Hopefully, we'd like to get it on as quickly as possible. I don't have an exact time frame, though.
Do you have a projection or a goal of how much you believe this could help reduce gun violence?
Well, it's hard to tell. You know, it's again, you can't predict people's intent or behavior, right? And you certainly can't control it at the end of the day. But if with all of these things working together sort of seamlessly is what we hope, we'll be able to get more in front of it than behind it. and that's what we're hoping to do.
And I'm wondering if eventually it helps get illegal guns and criminals using illegal guns off the streets. I'm wondering if, is it admissible in court as evidence? Has it been used?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It is.
Yep.
Yes.
Let me demonstrate the iPad real quick. It's basically the same thing, but I just want to give you the simulation of what the officer will have on his or her phone. It looks virtually the same as, I'll get that back up again. Looks the same as what you're seeing on the screen. So the officer has this, and an alert comes up, just like the alerts you guys send out as news alerts. The alert will come up on the officer's phone with some sort of sound indicating a hit, so to speak. So you get it on your phone just like we saw on the web-based platform here, and you're able to get the exact same data that we're able to look at, and you get it instantaneously from your mobile device. So just using an example of what we already discussed, the Duplin Street situation. Look at the list of calls, and you're able to get the same. So this is what the officer is able to get, and then safely go to the area with a lot more information than, quite honestly, you're getting now from dispatch, because you're able to see the geography and have a really good idea, if not a precise location, of where that gun was fired. So this is what they'll have, so they can put it on their mobile devices, and we all have our unique credentials, secure credentials, to get into the system.
There's no way to track this, but like, not everyone calls in 911 when they hear discharging, and so this would be bridging that gap. And so
it does. It actually does. You know, at the end of the day, we can't respond to something that we don't know about, right? This gives us knowledge, right? This gives us reliable knowledge that gunshots have occurred in that particular area. So, you know, again, we want to underscore the fact that 911 is still a critical piece in terms of the reporting, but this gives us the ability to know when there are gunshots in a particular area when we haven't gotten that 911 call.
How many sensors are currently deployed?
I couldn't tell you.
It's a number of them.
Quite a few.
Is this just stationary, or is it something that you can put on a vehicle and move around, or something?
Stationary.
Do you know what happened when officers got to that first one? I think it was Utah Place, you say, the first one?
Thanks for bringing that up. That actually was unfounded. Officers weren't able to locate any shell casings, any victims. So in all of the scenarios that we've shown thus far, there hasn't been a victim in any of them. And in one of the scenarios, officers located shell casings. And that would have been the Bentlow case, where we believe it was two rounds fired. So is that this one? So this is the unbelievable. It's just my luck, right? Let's see. Oh, it jumped too. All right, we'll go back over that in a second.
How within that radius, that circle there? I mean, is that how precise this technology is? And what like radius would that be?
It varies at times, but on this, I can't see it on this particular one. I want to say it was it 18 feet circumference of some radius of that?
82 feet.
Feet. 82 feet.
82
okay.
Feet from the sensor.
Right.
Yeah.
Did you get any false readings overnight?
No, we haven't gotten any false readings. All the readings that we've gotten thus far, we're confident were correct readings.
So there are a lot of municipalities using ShotSpotter. You mentioned Chicago. Chicago has a very, it's almost in half their districts now. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But Baltimore has tried this before, twice.
ShotSpotter?
I don't know about ShotSpotter, but this technology, this kind of technology, right? And it was kind of a miserable failure both times. What's different this time? Is it the technology? Is it the company? Or do you know?
None of us were here
at
the time that it was tried. And I just remember hearing anecdotes. The geography mattered around high-rise buildings where echoes and bounces and all. So depending on where they were placed versus where they're placed now. So we've done extensive testing to ensure that where we're placing it is of value. So in these areas, you're not in an area with a lot of urban infrastructure that might create false readings, et cetera.
But then there's also as a case of practicality, technology generally gets better than worse, right? So I think we may be experiencing some evolution in that technology.
Anything else? Just a quick housekeeping note. This was funded through Bloomberg Foundation grant, $860,000. This is for the initial kickoff. It'll be less as we move forward, if we chose to move forward, but a reevaluation in about a year. So we have a year paid for and up and running that'll include the Eastern District, and then we'll come back and reevaluate.
No, I've already commented on that. I've had a conversation with her. I don't have any further comment. I'm sure she'll make the decision that's in the best interest of the city.
All right, guys. I'll let them go because I know y'all want me to replay something for you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, guys. Yes, get the Wi-Fi fixed. Today is the budget hearing. See if we can get Wi-Fi. We can go. All right.
Did you disconnect it?
Thank you.
I went right now, and it's on a it was on the Wi-Fi that's in my office, so it was.